Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to show how to create a scene something like this. So you can see there's bullet holes being shot in this sign and then eventually it falls down. And if you look carefully, you should be able to actually see that the grass at the back here moves as well. But there it is. You can see holes appearing in the shadows and the grass moving, and you can see some holes in the wall there as well. So to show you what the scene looks like in Blender, there it is. And if I just play that, you can see there goes the sign. You can see some particles which weren't so clear in the video, and then you can see the grass moving around like this. So we'll start a new Blender file, and to begin with we'll just create the basic sign. So Shift A to add, and we'll add some text. So if I just rotate that, rotate RX 90, and we can see what we're doing. Into edit mode with tab, and there's some text for our sign. Now if you want to, you can obviously change the font. If you click here, you can go to your font directory on your computer and select a different font, whatever kind you want. But before I do anything else with this text, what I need to do is give it some thickness. So under the text panel, set the bevel depth up a little bit, set the resolution up a little bit. This is basically the bevel depth is a sort of corner on the edge, a chamfer, and the resolution will make it more rounded rather than flat. And then we want to extrude our text a little bit like that. So there we've got some depth to our text. So at this point we can Alt C and convert it to a mesh. Now whenever you convert curves, particularly text, to a mesh, there's always a bit of a mess in the mesh. So in edit mode, select all the vertices and click remove doubles. And you can see that removed quite a lot of vertices, almost 18,000 vertices. So that simplified that mesh quite a bit. Now we'll just give it a basic material. We'll just make it red, and that will do for now. So now we need to put our text on something. So Shift A, add another mesh, and it'll be a plane. Rotate that on the X 90. We'll look from the front, press 5 to go into orthographic mode, which takes away all the effects of perspective. Scale on the X, something like that. Scale on the Z, maybe a bit more on the X. And then we can just take it to the point where it just starts to cover the back of the text. Now I'll go into edit mode, press E, and then press the left mouse button, then drag that back a little bit to give the sign some thickness. And then what I can also do, if I select all of the outside vertices here, I'm not doing this in exactly the same way as I modeled the previous one, but there's obviously lots of different ways we can do these things. Press E, and then left mouse, then scale it out a little bit. I'll scale it on the Z a little more, and then we'll scale on Y, sort of bring it forward. E, left mouse button, scale, Shift Y, and then scale Y and take it in a little bit. And you'll see why we've done that in a moment. So we've created basically a frame. So I'm gonna look from the front. I think we need to bring these edges in a little bit. So scale X, there we go. So look from the front, just press 1 on the numpad, select everything, U, project from view bounds. So we've UV unwrapped this from this direction. Next thing I'm going to do is select that face in the middle to unselect it. I'm going to say new material, and I'm just going to give it, call it base sign. We'll just give it a sort of bluish color at the moment, fairly dark. I like to replicate that into the viewport color so you can see it fairly easily. Then we'll give it another color and we'll call that white sign. Currently we'll just make that a sort of yellowish colour, and we'll now select the middle area and assign that. So in material view you can now see we've got that. So I'm now ready to join my text and my sign. Before I join my text and my sign, I'm going to press Ctrl 1 to add a subdivision surface, but you can see it messes the sign up, and that's because I don't have enough vertices. So in edit mode, Ctrl R, move the scroll wheel to get two edge loops and just accept where they are, and then select this one. We're going to have to unwrap it again, and then scale on the X, and then do the same on the other one. So now scale on the Z, select everything, U, project from view bounds again. So now our sign is back. We'll set it to smooth shading, but now we've got rounded corners, which is much better. So I'm not going to worry about the uprights on the sign. But what I do need to do now is join those two pieces together. Now I'm going to get some effects on this text because of the subsurface modifier. So I'm going to add one to it now just to see what it will do. So I've just done that and it didn't really make any difference. so that's fine. With some text, particularly with very thin areas, you may get some of it distorted, so you may need to add the subsurf before you do anything. So I'm now going to join those two pieces together, click join, and there we go, we've got our sign. I'm going to actually apply this because it'll get in the way later on. And I've got quite a few vertices on the sign, but this is the main focus of the image anyway, so that doesn't matter. So for this one, I think I'm going to put the sign on a wall. So let's add a mesh and we'll say images as planes. If you haven't got this, go to user preferences and look for import export images as planes and tick that, and that will give you that function. You don't have to use this, it just saves you doing a bit of unwrapping as you go. So shift A, mesh, images as planes. It'll then ask you what image you want. So I'm going to select this wall texture, rotate x90, scale it up quite a bit, and I'm just going to leave the camera straight on for now. Obviously I had it at a bit of an angle previously, which means you need the wall a little bigger, so I'll put it about there. Now shift A, mesh, images as planes again, and this may not end up in the scene depending on what you do, but I'll add another plane with a path texture and we'll scale that up, and I'll just put my sign something like that so it's stuck on the wall for now. And you can see whether it's right against the wall as soon as it appears, because this is just an infinitely thin wall, as it were, it doesn't have any thickness dimension, you can see straight away. So we now need to add a lamp so that we can see what we're doing, and we'll add a sun lamp. Doesn't really matter where a sun lamp is, but it helps to see what you're doing if you put it somewhere sensible. And we'll give that a slight yellow color, and we'll try strength of 2, multiple important sample. Size will need to be smaller, and I'll demonstrate why now. So if we go to a rendered view, you can see there is a shadow there, but it's quite a blurred shadow. And you can see your shadows around here that are blurred. Now if that's the sun, and I'll put the brightness up a bit, if that was the sun, sun rays are actually quite parallel, so you typically get quite a sharp shadow from the sun. So we'll try 0.02. And now you can see it's a very sharp shadow indeed, and you can obviously go for somewhere in between. It depends, I guess, if it's an overcast day, then you'll have much more of a blurry shadow like that, but if it's a bright sunny day, then you'll have a much sharper shadow. I've gone for 0.03 there, and that seems pretty fair. Now I've obviously done nothing with the textures on the walls. I'll very briefly do that just to make them look a little better. So we'll bring up a new window and go to the node editor, select the wall. At the moment we've just got our image going into the diffuse, which goes into the material output. So we need some sort of bump on there now. So we could just take the color and put it straight into displacement like that. Straight away you can see that although it's doing something, it's the wrong way around. The mortar seems to be sticking out. We've got shadows there, and really they should be there. So if we add a color ramp, this of course is not the only way to do this, but it's a quick way to get this effect, and click that. Now you can see that we've swapped the brightness values, and now the mortar is lower than the bricks. And we can now select to tighten in basically on the area that we want. Now the level of that bump's still a bit high, so an easy way to fix that is put a math node in there, multiply and multiply by less than 1. So we'll say 0.2. Maps, that's a bit too small. There. So we've got a little bit of bump on there now, and obviously you can do more. You can use crazy bump and get a proper bump map created, and you then feed that into here. But for my purposes, this is good enough. It gives you a reasonable effect of a wall. And then if we copy those two nodes, we select the pavement or track as it seems to be, paste those in, and we'll do exactly the same there. Connect that into displacement. And I think maybe that's the wrong way up for that one. So we can just flick it round like that. And that just gives us a little bit more interest on the surfaces. It doesn't look so completely flat. Now, the other thing we can do, of course, is we can add a little bit of shininess to it. So we'll add a shader, which is a mixed shader, add another shader, which is a glossy. I got connected incorrectly. Nothing goes into the glossy, we just want white. So you can see we've got a very wet wall there. So we probably want fairly high roughness because walls aren't that reflective. But then what we do is we turn the factor down and the color of the wall comes back through. And that will often show up, especially if you take it towards the less rough side, the bumps a little bit more, and just make it a little bit more interesting. It adds another dimension, especially when you start to move the sun around. So for example, if I take the sun over here, rotate it on the Z, and then we'll have another look. And you can see it's a more extreme shadow now, because the sun's off to one side, and we can turn the glossy up a little bit there. And then so you can play with those. About 0.015 is probably plenty glossy for bricks, and you can play with the roughness value to suit. I also did a little bit with the color of the bricks, so you can just put a gamma node in there and just turn it up a little bit to darken them. It will also make the colors more intense, just to make them look slightly fresher bricks perhaps. So I can also add a glossy to this one, which is this one down here. Fairly rough, fairly bright, but with a low factor. Unless you want it to look like it's a wet street, in which case you then have the factor much higher, obviously. But that's just some quick textures there. I obviously want to add a little bit of shine to my sign as well. And what I'll also do, because I UV unwrapped it, and this is why I did, I'm going to add an image texture, and I'm taking it from my set of dirty textures, and we'll use this one, which is the one I used before. And what I'll do is I'm going to add a color mix node, feeds it into there. One side is going to be a pretty light color like that. The other side, I will take the same color, but then darken it quite a bit, more similar color. Then I use the output of this image to control that factor. Now it's upside down, so the easiest thing to do there, and there's other ways of doing it, the easiest method is to go into the UV image editor, make sure the whole sign is selected, rotate 180. And now you can see that the texture is sort of dripping down the sign rather than going up it as it was before. So that's a very quick way to get some dirt on the sign. You can add a vector mapping node to control that in more detail. You can also use this to control the shininess. So if I add another shader, which is the mix shader, and another one, which is the glossy, put that into there. What I can do is add color ramp. I'll put that up here this time. Take my image into there and take the output into the factor. Now, if we look somewhat side on, I'll turn that off for a minute. You can see the sign's a lot lighter because the light's reflecting off it. And if I turn this up, it gets brighter still. So now if I put the image into there and start to narrow this in a little bit, there are areas on the surface which are more reflective and areas which are less reflective. Possibly we want to swap that over. There we go. So now we've got where the sign's a little cleaner, where it's lighter, it's more reflective and less reflective elsewhere. And then to control the absolute level, we can play with this. So we just click the little bar there and click the color and affect that. So that just changes effectively what the range is that it's adjusting over. So that's another quick way to make the sign look used. And obviously, I wouldn't tend to worry too much about the dirt side of it on other elements of the sign because they're not so visible. But I would put the glossy into it like this. And again, or the red. So that's a very simple sign done. We're now ready to move on to the next bit. So now what we want to do is to animate this sign being shot and falling. But we'll do the falling first because we need certain pieces that are the broken parts of the sign, as it were, to fall with the sign. And you'll see why in a minute. I'm just going to do two shots because it's basically just repeating the same thing. But I want to show the sign sort of swinging loose and then finally falling. I'm actually going to raise the sign up a little bit as well. So the first thing is we need to create an animation. So the easiest way to do that is just go to the physics panel here and say add active with the sign selected. And if I press play now, you can see the sign just falls. So that's a start. The next thing is we need to make the ground a passive, so add passive, and then click play and the sign falls onto the ground. But obviously it's falling through the wall, so we need to make the wall passive as well. Now we may get a slight issue if the sign is actually poking through the wall, which it was previously, so give it a little bit of gap just to help the physics simulation. So that's good. So if we look from the front, we can see the sign's just falling. But what if we don't want it to fall like that? What if we want it to fall in two stages? So we want it to start to come away and then to drop. Or more importantly, what if we don't want it to fall yet? What if we want it to fall when we get to, say, frame 30? One easy way of doing it is to come into the scene settings under the rigid body world and set the speed as low as it'll go. Put 0 in and set the frame to 29 if we want it to start at 30, and then press I while hovering over the speed. Then come up to 30, set the speed to 1, and press I again. Now go back to the beginning of the simulation and play. There it goes. It fell at, it started falling at frame 30. So that's how we can prevent any physics from happening until we're ready for them to happen. But now we want that sort of double effect of it's swinging first and then falling. So at frame 30, we want it to swing and then we want it to fall all the way shortly after that. So what I'm now going to do is I'm going to add another mesh object. We'll make it a cube, fairly small, move it up to about here and fairly close to the sign. Doesn't strictly matter, but it helps with visualizing. So we'll now make that cube a passive. So you can see it's now got this green line around it, which means it's got a physics system on it. So we can now select the cube, which we already have, select the sign. So the sign's got a green line around it now as well, and say connect. And now if I press play, nothing happens. The sign stays exactly where it is. You notice we've got this new sort of empty here, which is the connection between this cube and this sign. So I'm going to move in a little closer and I'm going to move that to about here. And the next thing I'm going to do is rotate it on the x-axis minus 90 degrees so that now you can see each axis is labeled. The Z is pointing into the wall. Still doesn't make any difference. If I press play, nothing happens. But with that object selected, which is the rigid body constraint, and under the physics panel you can see it over here, what I can do is change the way that works. At the moment it's just a fixed connection. But if I set that to, for example, a point, and then press play, you notice now the sign swings. And that would work with hinge as well. The hinges work along the Z-axis. So we can see now that at the point at which we've got rigid body physics working, the sign suddenly starts to swing as though it's just come off some fixings. And then we want perhaps somewhere around frame 100, we want it to fall off completely. And the way we can do that is we can animate the enabled option here. So if we go to frame 99, press I while hovering over that, then go to frame 100, remove that and press I again, go back to the beginning of the animation and press play. There it's swinging, and there it is falling off completely. Now I'm not going to get into too much about making the sign jump when it, as it were, a bullet hits it, but just briefly, the way I achieved that to a certain extent was I added another mesh object. So I just added a UV sphere, fairly small one, put it somewhere in front of the sign, and we'll do it for after the sign started to swing. And we know it's going to fall off at about 100, so just before then, I can see the sign's about there. It's actually more complicated with the sign swinging this wildly. And I'm going to add that as a passive. So I add passive to this little sphere. A few more frames earlier, I think, I'm going to press I and select location for the sphere. I'm also going to control A and add scale just to avoid any problems. And we don't need anything too clever here, so I can say sphere for the rigid body collisions here. Now go to about, we need to go back to the beginning again because the animation's got upset. Go to about frame 99, 98 maybe. And what I need to do is to make that ball hit that sign. So I just bring it up to here so it's slightly impinging on the sign. Now this can add a little bit too much energy, so it can take a little bit of messing around to get it just right. But you see it's just about hitting the sign there. So I location. Now this is moving quite fast, this ball. And then what I immediately want it to do a few frames later is to be out of the way again. So I drag it back, I, and location again. So now if we press play, the sign swings, the ball goes in, and the sign falls off. And what we might need to do is to slow the ball down. And that's basically how you can get the sign to jerk as if it's being hit by something. But obviously in this case, the sign's right up against a wall, so we're not really getting much of an effect. There's perhaps a slight twitch of the sign there as this happens. And then off it goes. So I'm not going to worry too much about that, but that's really one way to get the sign to react to a bullet hitting it. So I'm going to take these objects and move them now into another layer so they're out of the way. Everything will still run. So we've got essentially the sign movement. Now we can leave it like that, but one of the problems with using a simulation is that anything you change can change what's going on and can cause some unexpected effects. So if we're, once we're happy with the movement of the sign, what we can do is bake that movement. And that's fairly easy to do. Under the rigid body physics, you can see bake to keyframes. So select the sign and just say bake to keyframes. Start frame, end frame, and the frame step. Typically, you don't want to go too much more than one if you've got fairly rapid motion. If it's fairly slow movement, then you can have more than that, and Blender will interpolate what's in between. So you just say OK on that. It will only keyframe what changes anyway. And in my case, there's quite a lot changing because of the swinging going on. And now you can see we've got a load of keyframes down here. So I can actually remove the rigid body physics name. So just click remove with the sign selected. There's no physics on the sign. And yet when we press play, it still swings as it did before and then falls. So we've now got our animation, our physics animation set up. So the next thing we need to do is to create some bullet holes. So I think the first bullet was probably over here somewhere because that obviously released the sign. So I'm going to select the wall and the floor and hide those. Now I'm going to add a new mesh, which is going to be a cylinder. I'm going to rotate that on the x-axis 90 degrees, look straight on, and in fact what I'm going to do now is scale it down a little bit, scale it up slightly on the y-axis, and now I'm going to go into edit mode and just randomly select some faces. So sometimes I'll have a couple of faces together. Don't make it too even though. Now scale shift Y because I don't want it coming towards the camera as it were, to bring those out a little bit. Then change this to individual origins and scale shift Y in, and you can see they get thinner then. And I think I'll add a new vertex there. And we've got now a sort of cut pattern for our bullets. You can spend more time and get that more interesting, but this is basically going to be a Boolean object. So bullet hole is what I called it. Save that. And now I can come over to my sign. I need to make this bullet hole smaller, obviously, but I need to get it in the right position and then scale shift Y. And we'll go for something about that sort of size. And we'll put the first bullet hole, something like that. I'm avoiding getting it actually in the text, but just because it can add to the complication and the time to process a little bit, but you don't have to worry too much about that. Note that what I also need to do is do this to the wall, which we'll do in a moment. So we'll save that. So next, select my sign, go to modifiers and add a Boolean modifier. Select my bullet hole, takes a moment because of all the vertices. And then we need to change that to difference. And as usual with Booleans, they do upset the geometry a bit, but we'll see what we can do about that. So that's now cut a hole in the sign. Now you will sometimes get this effect, and we can sort that out in a moment. So if we apply that, we can now take this away. And as I said, sometimes it will sort of add an extrusion in rather than subtract it. That's just, I think, a bug in the Boolean modifier, but it's not too much of a problem. We can select that ring of vertices there, X, and delete the vertices, and then do the same on the back here, X, vertices. And there we go, we've now got a hole through our sign. If we now select the back loop of vertices and the front, make sure they're all selected, and then spacebar, bridge, edge loops, that's joined them together. As you can see from the Boolean, we've got a bit of a mess to clean up. I'll just briefly show you some of the things you can do to sort that out. If you look very closely, you'll often get little multiple areas like this where there's multiple vertices. One quick thing to do is to select all the vertices and under tools go to remove doubles. This didn't remove any. You can change this distance in here, and that will then basically, what remove doubles does is it combines vertices that are very close together. You can increase this number and that will then effectively do that, but what you can also tend to do is mess up the geometry if you do that too much. But we'll go for a little bit, and there you can see it's removed quite a lot of geometry there. Let's just back off and see what it looks like. It's not too bad. And you can see we've only got a couple of vertices left, and we can sort those out now by selecting them there, Alt M and join at center, and then just have a quick look around the others. So we can see a couple there, Alt M at center, and there's some more. You will find when you've got a lot of vertices that everything starts to slow down. So just merging some more vertices. And that's not the only problem, but that's going some way to sorting it out. Starting to get better. And then we just need to really to isolate this little bit. So what we can do is, using the knife tool with K, the knife tool does suffer from lag a little bit when there's a lot of vertices in the frame. I'm just drawing with the knife tool around the object. It doesn't have to be particularly precise. It's just to isolate it. And you will find it doesn't always, it's not always successful in making the cuts. Now you can see we've pretty much isolated it there. You can spend a lot more time and do it more accurately. It's one of the problems of using booleans, they will mess up the geometry quite a bit. But you can see that's not too bad. It's fine that it's got a few little dimples in there. It looks like a good hole. So now we need to fill the hole in, because we don't want the hole to be there from the beginning. So back into edit mode, face select, holding the alt button down and right clicking on the edge of an internal face there. You can see I've selected the edge there, and I'm going to control plus just to make sure I get this area. And I'll just check around the back. Yep, that's okay. So I'm now going to do Shift D to duplicate that. And then I'll scale every axis except for the Y axis. So that's Shift Y, S Shift Y. To about there. I'm doing it this way so that I've got exactly the right shape. So I'm now going to press X and delete the faces. I actually don't need this one at the back, so I'm going to delete that as well. So I'm now going to go into vertex mode, select all of those, and Alt M at center. Control plus, so I've got the whole thing selected. So it's really just a little panel. And now I'm going to press P and separate by selection. So this is now, if I come out of edit mode, a separate object that's exactly the right shape to fill that hole. We go into rendered mode. Now you can see it's not mapped properly yet. And obviously it depends how visible it is. I don't think I bothered remapping mine. And in fact, what I will do, bring this one forward slightly and increase it a little bit just to fill up that sort of dent that's in there. As I say, you can spend more time getting this exactly right. And now I'll look from the front, go into edit mode, view, not bounds this time, just project from view. And it's roughly the right color. Obviously you can spend a bit of time getting it more precise and getting it lined up better. To hold shift down, by the way, you can move things a little bit in fine detail. So it's visible there, but if I back up, it's not really visible. It's not noticeable anyway. And obviously if you spend a bit more time and get it more precisely aligned, it won't be visible at all. Let's just play the animation and see what happens. You can see, because I've made it out of this object, that the animation is also applying to that piece of the object that's going around with it, which is very good. So what we want is, at this point, just as the plate moves, we want that piece to become invisible. So it's got all the same materials on it as the other one. We actually don't need the red material and we don't need the base sign material. We just need this one. But what we want to do is make it unique. So click the little number 2 there and just change the name slightly. I'll go into the node editor and here is our material, but I'm going to modify it now and I'm going to add a new mix shader, and into that I'm going to connect transparent shader. And to start with, it's all the way to the left, which means it's the normal color. But if you watch that little piece, as I turn that to the right, it becomes invisible. So all I now need to do is, if my sign is starting to move at frame 30, it moves slightly at 30, so frame 29 is when it's just about to move. So I'll go one frame before that, hover my mouse over that mix shader at 0 and press I, then go one frame on, change that to 1 and press I again. So now we can see, as the sign begins, just before the sign moves, the hole appears, and there it is. So that's an easy way to make the hole appear when we need it to. You could, of course, rather than creating a real hole, you could just draw the hole in vertices and apply this material to it, and that would work the same way. It would mean that you wouldn't get any internal geometry, which of course I've got because we created that hole in 3 dimensions within the sign. So you can see, for example, once the sign's got a hole in it, we're looking from behind now, you can see there's light shining through the sign. If I bring the walls and whatnot back, you can see the wall through there. And that's just our Boolean object still stuck up there. So that's how we create the bullet hole. That's how we get the sign to move at the point that we want. And of course, I would also create a second one for the point at which the sign actually falls. So that's where it swings, and then of course it falls. And I'd do a second one for that, but I won't do that in this instance. I've shown you how it can be done. But what we will do is we'll go on to the second element, which is volumetrics. So I'm going to move that object out of the way. So we'll call this up here the scene, we'll call this cycles. Then what we need to do is click the plus here and we'll say a full copy of the scene. It's best not to do this until you've got your light and your camera movement or position as you want them. You can link them, but it adds a little bit of complication. So it will call it 001 to start with, and I'll call this one volumetrics. And we change this to blender render or internal. So now when we click render, we get nothing. And that's because none of these materials have been defined as blender internal materials. And that's fine, because I actually don't want them to be. I'm going to put my cursor where my bullet hole is, and then I'm going to add, it doesn't really matter what, but I'll add an icosphere. Shrink that down a bit to roughly the size of the hole and just push it into the hole a little bit. This is going to be what emits the smoke at the point that we want it to. So now we go to Object, Quick Effects, Quick Smoke. And if we press play, we can see that we get smoke straight away, which is obviously not right. We know that that bullet hole appears at frame 2930. So that's about when we want the smoke to start coming out. With our flow object selected, which is the original object, go to density and set that to 0. Now if we press play, nothing happens, no smoke's generated. So we then come to about frame 29, press I to mark that. In fact, we'll go one before that. We'll go to frame 28 and press I there. So that's saying no smoke up to that point. Then go to frame 29, set the density to 1 and press I. Now we'll just go on, say 3 frames, we'll make it 2 frames, press I again, one more frame, set it down to 0 and press I again. So that should just give us a puff of smoke at the point that the bullet hits the sign. So let's have a look. There we go. Sometimes you can't see the smoke unless you have the domain selected. And there it is. And it's worth making sure that adaptive domain is switched on, because especially if you've got a lot of smoke to render, it'll speed it up. What we can also do is, in a minute we can turn on high resolution, but I'll turn the subdivisions up to 64 to make it a little better. You can go even higher if you want to. And now what I'm going to do is select the sign, click smoke and say collision, and we'll say animated under collision type. So I'll select the domain again. It'll probably take a little longer to simulate this time. And you can see that the smoke is interfered with somewhat by the movement of that sign, which is what we want, rather than it being completely independent. You can see it's been dragged down a little bit there, and there's a bit of vorticity as well generated. And there you can see the sign again interfering with it. So if we go back, I'll actually remove these walls from this scene, because this is our volumetric scene and we don't need them. And there it is. And you can see some of our smoke's been dragged down a little bit. And we can now just render that. So it's a little bit dark at the moment. Plus we can see our domain object with the object selected in the correct scene. It's an icosphere. We'll just turn off rendering. So now if I render, you can just about see our smoke, but the object doesn't show. Now what we probably need to do now is increase the brightness of our lamp in this scene, just to make the smoke give us a bit more smoke to work with. So we'll turn the energy up to 5, see what that looks like. There we go, it's a bit more visible. If we come back a little bit, see what it looks like there. The sign itself, of course, is not visible because, as I said, it doesn't have a blender internal material on it. If it passes in front of the smoke, you should see it interfering with the image of the smoke. It is, of course, still relatively low resolution smoke. I think we can afford to have the lamp even brighter than that. That's fine. And then the last thing is, we come over to the render settings and under shading, change alpha to transparent. Now at this point you could choose to render your, and this is what I did, render your animation for the volumetrics out to a file, which is fine. If you do, obviously you're doing it so that you can composite it later, and that's actually how the professionals do it, but you need to make sure, if you want to use the transparency, that you select RGBA. We can see it's transparent because we've got this checkerboard pattern rather than just grey. So you need to make sure you get RGBA selected when you output the file if you're going to output it to a file. But I'll also show you how you can composite it in one pass, as it were, rather than having to save separate files out. So that's our volumetrics pass, and we'll go back to our cycle scene now. So just to show briefly how to combine those two images, go to the node editor and select the scene and say use nodes. What I'll need to do is just do a short render of this image, but we need to do it at the point that there will be some volumetrics, so we'll come over here somewhere. So there's our sign swinging around. Okay, so we know that there should be some volumetrics over here somewhere. So this is our scene, this is the render layer we're currently seeing, and that's the composite output. So we need Shift D on that to create a new one, but this time come into here and select the volumetrics layer. We'll go up to add, color, alpha over, put one image into there, the other into there, and the output to there. And there's our volumetrics already. So at the moment that's just showing a sort of grey puff. What we can do, add a color mix node in there, change it to color, and change the color of the smoke to whatever we want. So I'm just giving it a bit of a color there. And what we can also do is vary the density of the smoke like this. The brightness of the smoke isn't really affected by that, but if we want to affect the brightness of the smoke, go to the color node and add a gamma node there. And then as you turn that up, smoke will get darker, but that will also intensify the color. So that's how I did the smoke, that's how I did the sign and everything else. The only thing I haven't done now is the grass at the bottom. So I'll select my plane at the bottom and we'll go into edit mode. I need to subdivide it a bit, and that'll do for that. Then I'll add another loop there and perhaps another one there. So I select all of those vertices along there, go into vertices and add a vertex group and assign it. You can give it a name if you want to. Next, with that selected, I need to add a material that's going to be my grass material. So click plus, new, grass, give it a fairly good green color, perhaps a bit darker than that. And we'll just quickly go into the node editor just to make it a half decent grass material. So we'll add shader, mix shader. So we'll mix the diffuse with translucent shader, add a color input, put that into both of them, then add a gamma node into the translucent one so that if light's shining through, it's slightly darker in color. Another mix shader, and this time a glossy. I've done this many, many times now. We want that fairly low. We'll try 0.02, and the roughness we'll keep where it is. So that's a basic texture for our grass. It'll need tweaking, but that'll do to begin with. So now we need to create our grass. So we go to the particle system, and we'll say new, and it's going to be a hair system. I want to make sure it's using the grass texture. There you go, it's green. We'll say beep, spline, and strand render. The length is probably much too long at the moment, so we'll go for 0.5. And now we want to come down to here, vertex groups, and change that to group. And now you can see it's just along there. So the amount of grass, we want to reduce that. Go to advanced, select vertices. And you can see that's sort of spaced them out a bit, albeit a bit too regularly. So what I will do now actually is go back to my vertex groups. I'm actually going to remove these vertices. So selected this row and click remove. I'm going to add a few more edge loops. Don't know how to do it this way, of course. So currently all of those vertices are selected, but I'm going to go around and just deselect a few of them, click remove. So now you can see we've got some gaps in there. So now go back to our hair. Need to just bring it forward slightly. I'm going to turn the grid off, it's confusing things. So you can just about see we've got some hairs just pointing straight up like that, and they're actually just the other side now. So what I now need to do is change the angle that they're coming out at. So on the Y, I'm just setting that slightly lower, and you can see they're now pointing this way. And I click hair dynamics and click play. So now we need to play with things like the stiffness of the grass. So you can see there, it's a bit too wilty. So we'll try 0.35. That's getting better. And we can play with the bending as well. So that's got some grass blades. Going back to faces, I think that's a little bit better. Add a little bit of random, and you can start to see how that works. So I've got a bit of random here. This one doesn't really make much difference. But now you can see I've got a few little bits of grass as though they're growing right in the corner of the street there. And if you, on vertices, it looks like they're coming out of clumps as well, which is better, but it's up to you. You can use faces, but it's a bit more general. This really just looks, I think, much more realistic and just looks the way I think grass does look as it sort of grows in the corner of the street. So if we have a look at that rendered, we now need to just adjust exactly what this grass is. I mean, you might want plants like this, but they're probably not going to wave as much as grass would. So we now need to go to the particle settings. So under cycles, hair, rendering, set it to curved segments, set it to ribbons, and then set the root to something like 0.2. And you can see we're getting something more closely resembling grass. It's not quite reaching the bottom. That's not an unusual problem. We can just move things around. And if you don't want the ends to be completely sharp, you can increase the size of the tip like that. And we'll make them slightly longer. Well, what we'll do now is we'll just add some randomness to them. So with a little bit of brownie, and that just adds a little bit more randomness to them. And we can obviously add a little bit more there. Now, one of the things you note is that they start off upright, which is obviously unnatural. And it takes them a second or so, 20 odd frames, to get to something more like you'd expect, for them to droop, essentially. Which is why when I did the final render, I actually started the render at frame 20 rather than frame 1. So it's worth bearing that in mind. Now the next thing I'm going to do to help to make that grass a bit more realistic is I'm going to add a force. And this will just be a turbulence force. And let's see what that does. And it's not doing very much at the moment because it's not very strong. So I'll turn that up. If I turn it up very high, you can see the grass is waving all over the place, which is too much. It's obviously just to simulate wind. If I try 50, perhaps just not quite enough, 75 maybe, just to add a little bit of movement to the grass as though there's a little bit of a breeze, maybe 100. And you can then change how much noise there is, the size of the noise and so on. And then I think I'll turn that down a little bit further as well, and the flow. So that adds a little tiny bit of movement to the grass, as if there is a bit of a breeze. But now what I want is a little bit of wind for this area. In my other sign, it was slightly further from the wall. So in fact, I'm going to move this back slightly just to help. But there was no issue with the sign passing through the grass there. I know the sign's now slightly in front of the wall, but you'd need to do that anyway, really. Because what I want to do is have the effect of the sign falling to the ground just in front of this grass here, and thereby affecting it with a puff of wind. And I did that by adding another force field, and this time it was a wind field. You need to rotate it on the X minus 90, so the arrow is pointing towards my grass here. It doesn't really matter where it is, but it's helpful to have it somewhere near what you want. And then what I'll do is I'll turn the strength up till I can see that it's affecting the grass. So about 60, I'll add a bit of noise to it, but we don't want it simply there. So we know that the sign falls to the ground something about there. So somewhere around 120, we want the puff of wind to affect the grass. So I'll go one before that, set the strength to 0, press I over that, go on one frame, set the strength to 60, go a few frames more, perhaps set the strength to 30, press I over that, then about there, set the strength back to 60, I that. And then a little bit further, set it to naught there. So effectively the wind is going up and down. So if we watch what happens now, we can see the sign goes down there, the grass is blown around a little bit, and then our simulation restarts there. And if I set that to 200 now as the end frame, and we've actually got nothing else rendered on our cache for the sign, so that's why it just stops. And also we need to set the end point for our particles to 200 in order for the particles to carry on being affected. Even though our sign stops, of course, because we've only recorded that much. So that's how you can do the dynamic grass. I'll just let it fall and then have a look at what that looks like rendered. There it is. And then the final little detail that I added was to add some particles. So come to another layer and add cube. Subdivide the cube a bit and then start to distort it. I'm thinking of this as metallic shards, so they need to be fairly angular in order to give us some nice reflections and what have you. But I'm just randomly distorting it. You can use modifiers. I've shown in some other videos how you can do that. What I'll do is, nowadays I prefer to do materials in the node editor, give this material slight bluish color with a glossy shader. Put some lights on and see what that looks like rendered. So it needs a bit more than that. So I'll add a noise texture and plug that in. Set the scale to something like 100. Use a color ramp. By using the color ramp, we can select not to have all of the noise come through. And add a math node. And if we set it to a negative figure, we can make the bumps come out. But these are going to be very small particles, so they don't have to be perfect by any means. So I'll create a couple more. When I did this, I created more than this and spent a bit more time on the detail. Really, it's just to make some different shapes. And then select them all, Control G, and call that shard group. Now go back to our main scene and select the object that covers our bullet hole and add a particle system, this time just a normal emission particle system, and we'll say for the moment 150 particles. Now we know this one appears at about frame 30, so start at frame 30 and go for say 3 frames. It's going to send a puff of particles out. Make sure the life of the particles is longer than the life of the simulation. Make sure you're adding the particles to the right object. So now I'm adding them to this object here. Doesn't really matter whether you use face or verts for this exercise. And if we just click play, you can see that about frame 30, a puff of particles comes out. So let's put a lot of randomness on it, and we'll hide the wall for the moment. It's less important with this one, but with the other one I wanted to make sure that the particles came out of both sides. And you can see, because I've added that random, we're getting a spray of particles at that point. What I now need to do, of course, under my particle system, is tell it to use a group of objects, which is my shard group. And you can see they're a bit on the large side at the moment. So let's try 0.01 and add some randomness to the size. And there they go. So I'll bring my wall back, and what I now need to do is select the wall and make it a collision object. It's actually a rigid body collision object as well, but that doesn't matter. I can even remove that. I need to click collision here, and we need to tell it what to do with particles. So I need it to damp particles a little bit. We can add some randomness into that and damp the friction slightly. I need to do exactly the same with the ground. Collision, particle damping. If you don't put this on, the particles will really bounce around, and some particle friction as well. So now let's go to material view and let's see what that looks like. And you can see the particles bouncing around a bit too much, and they're also affected by the wind as well. So you can see they're bouncing around a bit too much at the moment. They're really way too much affected by the wind as well. We can change that. We come down to field weights and we'll just set the wind down to 0. There you can see they're not affected by the wind now. And I can also set turbulence down to 0. They're ignoring the wind and the turbulence force fields now. And you can add just a little bit of those in there if you wanted to. They do tend to move around. But the main thing you need to do is to get that particle friction and particle damping about right. Otherwise they just bounce around way too much. And they need to be quite high, I think. Certainly particle damping does. There we go. So you can now see as the bullet goes in, we get a bunch of particles released and down they go. And we can also, if you really want to, we can even add some dynamic rotation. Click that for dynamic, add some initial velocity, add some randomness to them, and then the particles will even spin and rotate as they fall. So really, that's all there is to it. If I render that, there you can see some particles scattering away. You can see our grass being affected by the breeze. And there's our volumetrics being rendered. And you can just see that little bit of smoke puffing up there. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. I look forward to your suggestions, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.